Glenn McGillivray, Managing Director, Institute for Catastrophic Loss Reduction, Adjunct Professor, Disaster and Emergency Management, York University. We know how to prevent damage in low-grade tornadoes. So tornadoes that are EF0 to EF2, there are pretty simple measures we can take to prevent this sort of damage. We've been working on trying to change building codes and things of that nature for the last few years. It takes time, but this damage really didn't have to be. We're going to have a public number available on Monday, is what I'm hearing. It's not from us, but it's from the insurance industry. We'll get a better indication on Monday of what we're looking at. But as we've said before, it is higher than the Angus tornado from 2014, considerably more. We put a $50 million tag on the Angus tornado. That's not quite accurate because many other things happened that day. So Angus was somewhere in the, $35 million area. And so this storm will be higher than that one. Well, there's a couple of things going on here. We did have a group of affiliated researchers from the Northern Tornadoes Project went to the site within hours of the storm happening. They did find building code deficiencies. They did find a missing roof to wall connections and a few other problem areas. So certainly there were some building code deficiencies. I think we have to recognize that it's impossible, I think, for building inspectors to check every connection, especially when a subdivision is going up. It's very difficult. So a lot rests on the builder. And so we'll have to find out, what really happened there. The other thing is the lack of hurricane straps and things of that nature. They are not in the code as of yet, and we're trying to change that. But we do believe that through our research that a lot of this damage could have been prevented had those straps been in place. Yes, we have been working very closely with a counselor, one of the counselors who lost her home in the storm. They passed a resolution on Monday that will call on the provincial government to make hurricane straps included in the building code. We're also talking about possibly an incentive program to help builders pay to put these straps in. They're very inexpensive, but the city could possibly chip in money to have these things done. And that's an important thing to understand. We don't necessarily, have to change the code right away. Builders can put these things in voluntarily, and we've worked with builders in a few different places where these things are incentivized, and so they're not in the code, but builders are doing them anyway. So in Canada and in Ontario, a city cannot change the building code, but builders on their own can go above code if they wish, and we would like to see that happen. Barrie's had a couple of these over the years since 1985, and a couple of other close calls. Angus had one in 2014. There are measures that we can take to prevent damage, not just on the building and building code side, but there are other things, and that information is on the ICLR website, so you can look at our Protect Your Home from Extreme Wind booklet. But it would be good if together we can have a good discussion about changing the building code in Ontario, getting hurricane straps and other measures put into the code, and until that time happens, to talk to builders about possibly voluntarily putting these things in. Absolutely. Hurricane straps, we believe, can keep a roof on and up to an EF2 tornado, which is what we experienced in Barrie. That in tandem with just generally following the code as it is, could have meant that the 20 homes that lost their roofs would have been intact. And so we could definitely prevent this damage. We can prevent this disruption, this heartbreak, with just a few dollars a home. So we'd like to plot ahead on this.